Welcome to Tower Talk Business Radio, where we bring you conversations with the top business minds on Long Island and around the nation every week, featuring expert consultants and small business owners who have found success but are also willing to share their top tips, failures, and give gritty, matter-of-fact advice based on their firsthand experience. Now, let's get down to business on Tower Talk Business Radio, on the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC.
Hello, and welcome to Tower Talk Business Radio, powered by the Nassau Community College Foundation. My name is Ray Schwetz, AVP of NEFQ Business Banking, along with Donyshia Boston-Hill, CEO, keeper of the brand marketing and digital agency, and we're focused on being the premier resource for business and entrepreneurship.
Ray and I bring you weekly business advice, tips, tools, and services that help you grow your business. Plus, we interview the top business leaders in the industry.
So today's episode is an extra special episode.
I think so.
Yes. Definitely a personal connection here. You know, I'm always extra excited when we have a nonprofit, you know, that's here. And today, this is one that deals with an experience that, you know, I went through personally. And we'll talk more about that later. Helping provide us with business empowerment today is our guest, Sara Lipsky, Executive Director of the Leukemia and Lymphoma Society. And we're also joined by Jesse Giordano, who is a financial advisor with Opal Wealth Advisors and Hodgkin's Lymphoma Survivor. And he's also a board member at LLS. So just briefly about Sara. Sara Lipsky has a career in the nonprofit sector for over 20 years. She started when she was five and has been the executive director of the LLS LI chapter since 2013. Now, prior to joining the Long Island chapter of the Leukemia and Lymphoma Society, she worked 8 years with the New York City chapter as deputy executive director, helping achieve a 92% increase in revenue from when she joined. That's pretty huge. Development for mass market events with the National Multiple Sclerosis Society, try saying that three times, the New York City chapter, as director of development, and she worked on the MS walk, the bike tour. She holds a Bachelor of Arts degree in psychology from SUNY Albany, so she's much smarter than us. And she also resides in Jericho, New York, with her husband and two sons. So, Sara and Jesse, welcome to the show today.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah,
we're psyched to have you on.
So, Sara, can you share what your mission is? Like, bring me up to speed on, you know, your mission and all you do.
Sure. So the mission of the Leukemia and Lymphoma Society is to find cures for the blood cancers, and that includes leukemia, lymphoma, Hodgkin's disease, and myeloma, and to improve the quality of life of patients and their families.
Wow. Now, tell us a story, though, of how that applies to someone. You know, someone like me or someone like Jesse, who is a survivor.
Sure. So the way we fulfill our mission is really in three ways: through research, through patient services, and through advocacy efforts. So all three of those touch patients and caregivers as they navigate their cancer journey. Obviously, the research is really important as we continue to find better treatments and therapies for patients. We've seen survival rates double, triple, and even quadruple over the last 50 years because of that research.
Yeah.
Through patient services, we provide things like financial assistance, education for patients, and actually for professionals as well, caregivers. We have a really popular program called First Connection, where we match up patients who've been newly diagnosed with those who've gone through treatment successfully and act as a mentor. We have a huge online community and locally. And then in terms of our advocacy efforts, we have thousands of volunteers nationwide who help give a voice when we need it, when we're trying to push through important legislation and that surrounding getting our patients to get the best possible cures.
Yeah,
so I know that's a handful. We're doing a lot.
It's a lot. But I have to tell you that it's definitely something that when you experience an event, you know, and that's how I came to know of LLS was by experiencing the Man of the Year event that you did when the year that Jeff Weiner won. And it's just such amazing, you know, to hear the stories of those that are involved with the organization. It's mind blowing. So you know, I want to bring Jesse into this because I know he has a story that how he got involved with LLS, and I'd like to hear a little bit about that. So if you would mind sharing.
Yeah. About 15 years ago, I worked for Citibank at the time, and they had, there's the Light the Night Walk that's coming up in this October.
Yes.
And we had the opportunity through Citibank as employees to participate. So I got involved early, being a childhood cancer survivor myself. Wow. It just, as soon as I heard about the Light the Night Walk, I was like excited to participate and the opportunity to work with friends and family to raise funds together. And with just some simple letters and emails out, we raised, you know, just from my office, $10,000 to $15,000 just from some simple emails and letters. And it was just, like, I got attached to it.
Wow.
5 years later, I changed a job, went to a new firm. I wasn't as involved, and then was introduced to Sarah about a couple of years ago, and she asked me to get involved again. And
she brought you back in.
Yeah, after a few months of some repeated emails and some repeated requests, eventually I was like, all right, let's get together. And then I found myself sharing my story one day at a big event in preparation for Light the Night last year.
Now, from a perspective of someone that's kind of going through treatment, or how do they become connected to you guys? How does that happen? I mean, just like from a, I guess, more granular standpoint, I know you have all these services, but how do patients become aware of LLS and how to get involved?
So it's doing things like this.
Okay.
Right? So thank you for the opportunity.
We're glad to do so.
And then really it's through our massive numbers of volunteers talking about, you know, part of what Jesse does as a board member, mm-hmm. part of what you're doing, in fact, is, you know,
I'm
just talking about our mission. And
yes.
when folks hear that someone's had a diagnosis, referring them to us so that we can just be there for as a source of resource. And we partner with local hospitals and healthcare providers. And so they're referring patients to us. So wherever we can find community events like Light the Night, of course, attracts, you know, that event attracts over 6,000 people to Eisenhower Park. So that is a big, it's an awareness walk. Mm-hmm. So that's also a big draw for us. So we're getting folks in a multitude of ways.
So basically, it's hard to avoid.
That's our goal.
Excellent.
But sometimes we consider ourselves the best kept secret because yeah. we'll hear from patients sometimes afterwards, oh, I wish I knew about, or I wish I knew more about you so that I could have relied on your resources. So that's why getting the word out is so important.
It is. Yeah. I mean, that's huge because, like I said, it's something that when you experience it, it's mind blowing just how much you have to offer. Now, tell us a little bit about some of the challenges that you faced, I would assume that getting people to know about the services, what are some of the other challenges that the organization faces?
So I would say, feel free to chime in here too, in your experience, Jesse, but I think, you know, we're really trying to build our volunteer leadership community, so those who are willing to take on larger roles beyond, of course, it's very important, those event volunteers who are handing out, checking people in and handing out water and all of those things make us work, and we could not do it without their support. I think just looking for volunteers at leadership levels, whether they're interested in joining our board or taking on a larger role. So I think that's one of the things. And then back to, again, it's awareness is really another big challenge of ours, is making sure patients are aware of our services.
Yeah, there are so many nonprofits on Long Island, but what really strikes me personally about you is that when you go through the experience of an event at LLS, it's the stories that you hear from everyone that is involved and from, you know, families who have gone through this. And I'm trying to think of some good examples, but you're probably going to do more justice to it than I would. So do you have some examples of some ways that, you know, families have been impacted and some stories that you could share?
Through cancer itself, but after the diagnosis? I was 8 years old when I found out that I had Hodgkin's lymphoma. And I remember just, you know, getting ready for school that day, that one morning, and brushing my teeth, and my mom comes up behind me and gives me a kiss on my head, and then she put her hand on the side of my neck and she felt a lump.
Wow.
And a series of tests, and I can remember vividly the moments in the hospital, in the, coming down from the biopsy that I had, rolling down on the stretcher back to my room, and sitting in the room with the doctors, and then ultimately I found out that I had Hodgkin's lymphoma, and I had to go through the special medicine for the next 7 months.
Wow.
And that treatment, I can still remember the burning vividly in my arm, from the chemotherapy and the ice cold, that with this alternating heat and cold, and just kind of trying to struggle, just suffer and stay strong through the treatment, and eventually, you know, pass out and get exhausted, and just enduring that for 7 months. And what treatments have come a long way.
Mm-hmm.
The survival rates, it's impressive. All the things are happening, but the toxicity and the impact of treatment is still significant on families and patients.
And I'll add to that, for kids, the most common form of child leukemia, there's a 90% survival rate. So it's really good. Right. Treatments have come a long way. 50 years ago, we're talking about a 3% survival rate.
Wow.
But the challenge is that kids typically, the standard course of treatment for kids is typically with off-label drugs, which basically means they're being treated with what was an FDA-approved treatment for adults, and just pared down.
Wow.
And what we see now is that although most kids are surviving, there's still kids that are not, so that's important to address.
Right.
Two, 80% of kids who do survive see long-term cognitive and physical side effects. And that's because really they're being treated with chemo. And so our goal now is to get out of the business of chemo for kids. And we, as an organization, we are actually launching currently, it's hot off the presses, a children's initiative where we're, as an organization, investing $22 million over the next few years in specifics to pediatric research.
Oh, wow.
So, yeah, it's an exciting initiative for us.
You are listening to Tara Talk Business Radio, powered by the Nash Community College Foundation. My name is Ray Schwetz, along with Donyshia Boston-Hill, CEO and Keeper of the Brand Marketing Digital Agency, and we're focused on the LLS today. So with the sponsors that are coming in, how do you partner with them, and where does the money go? So $22 million, we know where it went. What are some of the other initiatives, though, that you pull those resources into?
So we're really split in three ways in terms of our dollar spend: through research, patient services, and advocacy efforts.
Mm-hmm.
So, just to answer your first question, in working with partners, we work with a wide range of businesses here on Long Island,
mm-hmm.
And whether it's a small mom and pop shop to a really large business. This year, we're fortunate. Our chair of our walk is chief legal counsel for MSC Industrial Supply, and they've been huge supporters, and that's a giant company, one of the largest employers here on Long Island. So, and I think, you know, the important thing for us is that it really does, you know, not to sound cliche, but it takes a village. And so getting people of all and businesses of all walks and sizes is so important to us. And when we go in, I think that's one of the things that we do uniquely is really work with those partners and say, what is it that you would like to see yourself get out of this, your employees get out of this? What are your marketing goals? And we try to address that. We're not the organization that will slide across a grid across the table and say, pick a level. We really want to better understand how do we complement whatever it is that you want to accomplish.
So it's a true partnership.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's fantastic. Now, tell us a little bit about some of the other accomplishments that that you've had. Because, again, I mean, it's one thing to experience an event, and it's one thing to hear the stories. But you've accomplished so much over your 20-year career and over the time with LLS and the Long Island chapter. So tell us some more of the accomplishments that that the organization's had.
Oh, boy. I might pivot a little bit because seeing a really great accomplishment right now that actually Jesse is spearheading through one of our another campaigns called Man and Woman of the Year. So I'm going to let Jesse talk a little bit about that.
Okay.
Okay. So the Man and Woman of the Year is a friendly competition amongst local professionals, business leaders, community participants, family members, to who can raise the most amount of money in a 10-week sprint. And it happens between the end of March through June. And we're actively looking for community leaders who want to get involved to help us raise the funds that will make a profound impact, that will find the next cure, relieve the difficulties that are associated with treatment, help us continue to advance the advocacy work to bring greater access to more and more patients, not only here in the U.S., but around the world. So
will you talk about what you're doing in terms of forming a committee?
No, sure. So we're we're out to identify 20 leaders in the Long Island community to participate in this campaign next year.
Okay.
So right now, you know, to identify 20, we need a committee of people, because I don't have that big of a Rolodex. I don't even have a Rolodex anymore. Does anybody have a Rolodex anymore? But so if
I don't even know if people know what that is anymore.
Right. Certainly not on the college campus for sure. We're out to identify 20 community leaders to come together to raise funds in this friendly competition, but it's going to take a committee working together to identify those people throughout the Long Island community to ensure that we have an appropriate representation of everyone.
Yeah.
So right now we have our first committee meeting that's launching in September, and it goes through December.
Okay.
And it's an opportunity for people to come together, identify those leaders that are right here in our own backyard that will find that next cure.
Well, I think that's great, because I think one of the things that, for me, I know is a challenge is somebody wanting to do things is that you don't know what level to jump in at. You know, sometimes you're overwhelmed. You think, well, I can't raise all that money.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But, you know, so there are so many different ways you can be involved.
I think for our listeners, you know, Jesse, you have a connection to this disease, and you're looking for volunteers, and there's so many organizations out there. Mm-hmm. How do you differentiate yourself to say, this is why you should volunteer here?
Yeah. No, it's a great question, and there are so many organizations out there. A lot of my peers who I really admire are doing incredible work. And I think one of the things that sets us apart, one, is that not a lot of people know that the research that we're doing is not just impacting blood cancers, but really having a wide impact on all cancers and even other diseases. A lot of research, researchers are really attracted to study blood as a medium. It's easier to study than solid tumors. So what we see is, although something may be approved initially to treat a blood cancer, it eventually will go on to be used and approved for treatment in other cancers and even other diseases. So I think that's an important distinction.
Yeah.
I think the second thing is that we take great care. You know, we operate much like a business, and we really, our customer service is, I think, exceptional. I think one of the things that we pride ourselves on is really working with that, whether it's a company, as I was talking earlier, mm-hmm. or whether it's an individual, is trying to find what's the right fit for them. Not just saying, hey, you want to volunteer? Great, you're going to go do this.
Right?
It's saying, well, what are your skill sets? What are your interests? What's your time like? And trying to then navigate. We have so many opportunities, and we have so much need. I will, you know, I always say to someone, if you want to volunteer, I promise you, I will find the right thing that will fit for you. We will find it. We have it. We have enough stuff going on. We're busy enough that we have it. And so we really work with folks to be able to do that. And so I think that's the really other big thing.
If I can just add to that, you know, to find the next cure, it's going to take a movement.
Yeah.
So it's not just the people who work at the charity that's going to make the difference. Now, the staff, and you asked about Sara before, Sarah's extraordinary. The staff, each and every single person has a heart that's massive and their commitment that's incredible. But what moved me about participating in Leukemia and Lymphoma Society is that it is designed to empower the community to find the next cure and to be the working boots on the ground, as opposed to, say, give more money to the organization and let them do the work themselves. It's right. about empowering everybody. So leadership is really key. So it's very inspiring to see all these people coming together at like one of the couple of few events that you've attended.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Whether it be the gala, whether it be the walk, the Light the Night walk, or be the Man and Woman of the Year competition, or the activities that occur in the schools, bringing people together in communities, and communities get to experience creating the cure.
Now, can you share some of your accomplishments that, you know, you can, you know, share with our audience today that will make them pick up the phone or go to your email or website to join and become a leader and volunteer or donate?
Yeah.
Right. Well, and I think that that's an important thing, too. I think people need to know that there's a point person to reach out to, and as I think we've heard, you're the person to speak with, because you'll help them figure out, and I can say that personally, you know, you're the person that'll help them figure out what way you can be involved.
Yeah.
But go ahead.
So, you know, as I previously mentioned, we have now a 90% survival rate for the most common form of childhood leukemia, which is ALL. We're in the middle right now of overseeing a master clinical trial for mm-hmm. an aggressive form of leukemia called AML. Mm-hmm. That was put together because AML has a 20% survival rate 5 years out. So it's really dismal. Treatment options have not changed in 40 years, and to us, that is unacceptable. So we have convened many different institutions and arms to actually run a master clinical trial. It's the first time a nonprofit has ever been given an IND, which is basically the designation you need to run a clinical trial. It's given by the FDA.
Oh, wow.
The FDA saw us as a leader in the field and said, yes, we would like for you to do this. And so we're very excited about this clinical trial for a couple of reasons. One, when you're given the diagnosis of AML, you are immediately put into treatment. You go right from the doctor's office into treatment. It's an aggressive form of leukemia.
Mm-hmm.
So within that, we are sequencing patients' genomes within 7 days of diagnosis.
Yeah.
To give a context, in the past, it's taken about 4 to 6 weeks to have this happen. And the goal of that is to identify what the mutation is and to actually treat that mutation, right? So again, it's aggressive. We're up against time. So we put a 7-day benchmark on this, and we've now made it about 95% of the time we are meeting that 7-day benchmark, which is really exciting. The second thing that makes this trial unique is that we are, so let's say two patients, A and B, have a similar genetic mutation, and they're getting two different treatments. They're in different arms of a study, and one is working better, right, than the other. They will, in real time, change the treatment for the other patient, which, as most people know, in a clinical trial, you're given your protocol and that's it till the end, right? There's no changing midway. So we're really excited. The head of oncology at the FDA actually told our CEO, not only do I think that this is going to change the outcome for AML patients, but it's going to change the way in which clinical trials are run, period.
Wow.
You are listening to Tower Talk Business Radio. Our guest today is Sara Lipsky of the Leukemia and Lymphoma Society, joined by Jesse Giordano, financial advisor of Opal Wealth Advisors and Hodgkin's lymphoma survivor himself. My name is Donyshia Boston-Hill, and I'm here with Ray Schwetz, and we're on 90.3 WHPC.
So I wanted to ask you, you alluded to this before, do you collaborate with other nonprofits?
Yes.
Okay.
So we work with, our missions really complement a number of nonprofits like Ronald McDonald's House and Make-A-Wish. And there's a ton out there that we will often refer to. No one's doing what we're doing exactly, but that's why we make great partners within the community.
Yeah, and I think there needs to be more of that because it's just amazing. Cancer touches people in so many different ways. There's so many different initiatives that you're involved with. And as you said, the results, they speak for themselves, and they affect, you know, other forms of cancer, and they affect other other individuals and other organizations. So
we have a great information resource center, and this mm-hmm. is a place where anyone can call or go online, chat, email. We have everything. and talk to a specially trained specialist about their diagnosis and what they're facing, what challenges they're facing. And if we can't help them as an organization, we will refer them to someone who can. And that's really important.
It is. And I think, like you said, it's everybody talks different ways now. I can't call my daughter. I have to text her. Otherwise, she won't answer. But anyway, so this is a tough question. But I think it needs to be asked. I mean, if there's one thing that you wanted to leave our listeners with, what would that one thing be?
You know, I think just the power of what one individual can do mm-hmm. is pretty remarkable. You know, people, you know, will often say to me, well, I don't have a lot of connections, or I can't raise a lot of money, or I think, you know, although that's important to make our organization tick, I mm-hmm. think there is something for everyone, and I think everyone has an incredible resource and talent, and so it's just about harnessing that, and so, you know, we really welcome and everyone's help in moving our mission forward.
Oh, yeah. Well, as Jesse said, I think, like you said, it takes a village, and, you know, everyone has a unique talent. Everyone can contribute in some way, and that's something that, you know, I've learned, and I hope all you that's listening that you're learning that as well.
I'd like to find out a little bit more about the Light Up the Night event.
Yeah, because mm-hmm. that's the event that's coming up soon, right?
Yeah. So Light the Night is our annual awareness walk that will be taking place at Eisenhower Park on Saturday, October 19th. Mm-hmm. Check-in starts at 5:30 and the walk itself starts at 7. In between that time, we have a very festive area. We have a kids zone and food. But our walk is really unique in that we get about 6,000 folks and they carry illuminated lanterns of one of three colors, red for supporters, white for survivors, and gold in memory of a loved one lost.
Wow.
Yeah. And the walk is very doable. It's a little over a mile long. And then when everyone comes back, we do a fireworks show that's donated by Grucci. And so we are literally lighting the night. And for us, light is representing bringing hope to the darkness of cancer.
Yeah. No, that's going to be an amazing event. I can't wait to participate. I'm very excited. Me and my family will be there.
Great.
Friends, supporters. I'm going to make Donyshia be there.
Yeah, and anyone can registration is free, and anyone can register by just visiting our website, lightthenight.org, and learn a little bit more about the walk.
I think the most important thing is to volunteer, to donate, join you for Light Up the Night, and get involved. Join the board, right, Jesse? That's what we really want everyone out there listening to do. That's my takeaway.
Yeah, like, what should we be excited about, right? Maybe that's the question. There's some exciting things on the horizon. Some really amazing things happen.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'll take that question for a second.
Let's do it.
We're close. Like, there is like a tipping point, and we're like nearing it or at it. There's so many exciting things happen.
It's not just pie in the sky.
No, it's not just like someday, maybe, hopefully, and we're just going to push this thing along. Like, it's shifting. 5, 10, 15, 20, 30 years ago, maybe one, two, or three new approval of medications happen.
No.
Right? Over the last 2 years, correct me if I'm wrong, 49 new treatments in 2 years. In 2 years.
Wow.
Versus one, two, or three. Five would be like a banner year. People are jumping up and down on their desks.
Yeah.
Now, 49 in 2 years. So all of the work and the effort that people are putting in is making a really profound difference. So if we can just harness some more energy, some more focus, some more boots on the ground, and we can push this over the edge, it'll make the difference. So whether it's Light the Night or participation in Women of the Year, mm-hmm. or joining a committee or participating in just raising some funds in your school, all those things together is going to push us over the edge and we'll have a cure.
And we literally have a program for everyone from school age, early on, elementary, preschool, up through high school, and then, of course, adults. There's literally something created for everyone. So
we need to contact you. So, again, just give us that contact information before we wrap up.
So I would say the best thing is you could visit our website because it has a wealth of information. So that's www.lls.org. Or our local office number is 631-370-7530. But the website is probably a little easier.
So thank you for being with us, Sara and Jesse. We really appreciate it. We want to leave you with DB's philosophy.
The bad news is time flies. The good news is you're the pilot.
We want to thank you for being with us. My name is Ray Schwetz, along with Donyshia Boston-Hill, your co-host and producers. The creative director of Tower Talk Business Radio is Rudy Britty. This is an NCC Foundation Business Leaders Council production. Visit ncc.edu/WHPC for more information. Available on iHeartRadio as a podcast on iTunes, Android Podcast, and Spreaker. This has been Tower Talk Business Radio, powered by the Nass Community College Foundation. On the voice of Nass Community College 90.3 WHPC. We'll talk with you next week.